Alright, so, have you ever heard the old joke? It was like an old New York man standing on a corner and some tourist walks by with a camera around his neck and he asks the old guy, how do you get to Carnegie Hall? The old man says, practice. Right? He's asking for directions to a place and Carnegie Hall is a place where you talented performers go and perform.
Oh,
yeah. So he says practice. Well, same advice for related race problems. How do I do this related race problem? How do I get good at related race problems? Practice. So, nothing better than practice. You get used to the idea that you're going to write an equation and take the derivative. Okay, once you get that, you know, that becomes a regular thing. Then you get used to finding the things that you need to figure out, right? Basically, you figure out what the question is asking. What's it looking for? All right? And then you figure out, how do I write equations that I will then take the derivative of? That when I do that, I'll get what I'm looking for. Okay? And it's very simplest, you know, if we're sucking all the fun out of it, there are things in the question, or in the information, that we can definitely throw together and figure it out. Here, we got a triangle. Okay, so we're thinking about the triangle. Its base is changing, it's equilateral, so it's always, it's scaling up, right? The bigger the base gets, the bigger the height gets, the bigger the other sides get, all the sides are always the same. So it's getting bigger, so its sides are getting bigger, its height is getting bigger, its area is getting bigger, its perimeter is getting bigger, if I want. Okay? So, what we need to think about is, what are they asking for, what do they give us information about, and how do I use that to solve this problem? Okay? So, base growing, fine 3, I don't want to get tied up in the specifics quite yet, how fast is the area, right? How fast is the area changing? That's an important question. So it must involve the area. And at some point I will want to find how fast the area is changing, which we call dAdt, meaning you take the derivative of the area function. How many ways are there to find the area? Lots. There's lots. Okay? But we want to use an equation that uses values that they talk about. They may not give an exact value, but they talk about the value. They talk about the values of the base. We're talking about the base. And if the base is growing, well, then all the other sides are growing as well. They're all the same. And it doesn't really matter. Equilateral triangle, all sides are the same. So, is there an equation for the area that has something to do with the base? The most straightforward one, right? 1/2 base times height. There are equations that give you the area based on angles. There are equations that give you area based on several different things, okay? The one we want to use is the one that comes to mind right away, 1/2 base times height. Now notice, they tell me how fast the base is changing. They tell me how big the base is, right? I know a lot about the base. How much do I know about the height? I know anything about the height, okay? But I have been given this hint that the height is equal to root 3 over 2 times the base. Maybe I'll use that sometime. Can we use it right now? How do we use it?
It's h in the area equation.
Look at that. Then we'll have an equation that is all base, just base, no height. The height, which we know nothing about. Now we can figure out what the height is. We can figure out how fast the height is changing. That'd be kind of a... It's nice to be able to replace things in the function before you take the derivative so that, well, you have fewer variables, you have fewer functions of t, so that you don't have to use so much of like the product rule or quotient rule. It's all in terms of one variable. That's nice. So we have area equals 1/2 times base times root 3 over 2 times base equals root 3 over 4 b squared. All good? So, let's take the derivative. dA dt equals?
Root 3 over 4, 2b.
Root 3 over, how about root 3 over 2?
Yeah.
B.
A,
b, dt. Remember, we're treating b like a function of t. B is like an inside function, so we have to use a chain rule, just like we do with implicit differentiation. How fast is the area changing? That's a question. Root 3 over 2 times base, do we know the base?
Yeah.
It's 25. Do we know dB dt?
It's 3.
Are you sure it's positive?
No.
Yes.
How do we know it's positive?
It's growing.
It's growing. Growing means getting bigger. Okay, so that is 3. Alright. Maybe I could have picked a number that canceled out this 2. I didn't. I don't know why. That's just the way it is. 75 root 3 over 2 what?
Inches squared per second.
Inches squared per second. Anybody have a decimal? No?
No.
75 root 3 over 2, or it's an approximate decimal representation. Okay. First, I'd like to identify the question. What are they looking for? Radius of the sphere, how fast? Okay, this is the question. How fast is the surface area changing? Here we go. Probably. That's an equation I'm going to be interested in knowing. I did ask about the area. Okay, great. What do I know? I know something about the radius.
DRDT
is?
-4.
Very good. It's getting smaller. It's decreasing. -4. How fast is the surface area changing? Oh, how fast is it changing? What is? DAET. I'm going to take the derivative of this function, right? Yeah, that's a good thing. Okay. Well, there's only one variable here. It's just R. I know stuff about R. I'm just going to assume it's safe to take the derivative and then see what I need to figure out. What do we get?
8 pi R
dr dt. If I knew the radius and I knew dr dt, oh, I do know dr dt. If I knew the radius, then I just plug it in, and there we go. But I don't know the radius, right? What do I know? The volume is 100 centimeters cubed. What good does that do me?
You can solve for R.
You can solve for R by saying the volume is 100. 100 equals 4/3 pi R cubed.
R spelled.
What?
Period.
Okay. So multiply by 3 over 4 pi, and get 300 over 4 pi, or 150 over 2 pi. That is R cubed, the cube root of 150 over 2 pi equals R. So DAT is equal to, here I'm going to go ahead and do -4 times 8, -32 pi times the third root of 150 over 2 pi. How close is this to the right answer?
It is
the exact right answer. Exactly right. Once I take the third root of 150 over 2 pi, now I'm approximating. And my point is, did you put that on the AP test? Full credit, right? They don't care to get the decimal. They don't care if it looks like 8 times pi times -4 times the third root, or times the third root of 150 over 2 pi times -4. They don't care. As long as it is equal to the correct answer. And if you give them a decimal, then they can get credit for that.
So, instead of cube root 150 over 2 pi.
Yeah.
The cube root of 75 over pi. Is that okay?
Oh, sure.
Oh.
Yeah, we could have divided that by 2.
Okay. So if we do it as a decimal.
What is the decimal?
289.47.
289.47
centimeters.
What?
Squared per second.
Squared per second.
Right.
Oh, negative. Because I had a negative there. Because it's getting smaller, right? So the surface area must be shrinking. Must be decreasing. And this is great, because how many times have you seen a sphere shrinking and wondered how fast is the surface area increasing? Now you know.
When the snow starts to melt.
The snowball?
Snowman.
You'll notice a lot of questions on the AP test are a snowball, a spherical balloon.
Well, that's a good one.
A balloon,
an orange,
oh,
being drowned in disaster.
But a balloon is
I've never seen a spherical balloon. That's
yeah,
balloon.
No, they're all like balloon. Mm-hmm.
The only balloon that's like nice
one.
And circular is like a, that I've seen is a mylar, and that doesn't get like
yeah,
it's not a sphere at all times.
Isn't
one
a balloon
forever.
Like its own shape?
Yeah, it's a balloon shape. Other things are shaped like balloons. Balloons aren't beholden to other shapes to define them.
Mr. Sheriff.
I've cut this piece of paper. Squares out of the corners, exactly the same size squares out of every corner, and folded it up to make a box.
Oh, that was a good picture. So,
yeah.
Oh.
Looks like a, I don't know what it looks like. Okay, so then we've determined that if this is X, then the height of the box is X, because we fold the flaps up and we get the height of the box. And so now, we want to write V of X, meaning volume as a function of X, the size of the square that we cut out. What's the volume of the box?
Side squared.
No.
Base times height.
Just
base
and
side times
words.
Height. Yeah, all of the lengths times each other, right? All of the measurements of the sides. And remember, this is a what we call a a rectangular prism. So the volume of any prism, that is a shape, that it's a three-dimensional shape that the two faces are exactly the same. And it's just a straight shot from, say, like this face to that face, this face to that face, this top one to this bottom one. And this is a prism in three different ways. We just need the surface area of one side times the length of the box, the width. We can take the surface area of this, multiply it by this length, surface area of this guy, multiply by that, surface area of the bottom, whatever. Take the length, times the width. How do we write that in terms of x? Let's call this the length, and this the width, and then the height is, well, obviously x. So we'll let the height be x. How about the length? Let's talk about the length. How do we get the length? This guy right here, the long. 11 minus 2x. Why 11?
Because that's the length of the paper we started with.
Right. Standard piece of American paper. 11 inches. Why minus 2x?
Because 2 of the width is.
We've got an x coming off of this side, and we have another x coming off of this side. So this guy right here is 11 minus an x minus a second x. And so that means the width would be 5. Okay? So, we talked about, we looked at the sketch of the graph, and we noticed that the sketch of the graph of the volume function had three zeros. Where are those zeros?
Zero.
Zero. And?
4.25.
That's where this square and this square touch because they're both half of 8.5. And this other guy?
5.5,
because that's where this square meets this square. The funny thing is, though, if this square meets up with this square, they're already big enough that these squares are overlapping. How do you have empty space overlap? In the real world, it makes no sense. Mathematically, we've got negative space, negative area, negative distances, negative lengths. These two are matching up, so that's okay, but the overlap of these is negative. So what we actually get in between these two values, like once we go beyond the point that these two touch each other and they start overlapping, and we have a negative measurement, we actually get negative volume. So we have one negative length going on there. So between 0 and 4.25, obviously, we're going to get some constructible box and have a positive area, or a positive volume. So the volume is 0 here. It's bigger, it's bigger, it's bigger. It's got to be 0 at some point, and it must come from here. It's a continuous function, right? So it must get big and then get small again, and then we get these volumes down here because we have one negative measure. It'll be from these guys overlapping. But once these will always overlap after that. The bigger x gets, the more the distance of these spaces overlap, so we have a negative. Once they overlap again on this side, we have two negative lengths. And so we have, and x is always taken to be positive. So we're back into positive volumes. Of course, that's nonsense. None of that stuff past 4.25 makes any real sense in the real world. So we're talking about this negative here, right? So at some point, what happens to the volume? It's maxed out. There is a maximum volume. I maybe should have asked you this before we started, but a lot of times when I ask people, like a class full of students, which value of x do you think is best? I get quite a few, it doesn't matter, it'll always be the same volume because you're always using the same size piece of paper. But of course, you know that's not true. You can make x very tiny and you have this just sliver of a height. You couldn't fit much in there. You can certainly fit more if you, somewhere in between. Value. What do you think the best value of x is? 2.125? Let's take some guesses. Any other guesses?
Two.
Is that right now?
Just because it makes
sense. Just two. Wouldn't that be elegant?
Yeah.
Any other?
I guess 2.125.
Okay, 2.125. Well, it sounds like 2.125 is a popular one. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to use calculus. What I want you to do is multiply this out so we have it like a more usable function. Okay. Do that. Also, now you can write it in its multiplied form, you know, its expanded form, or its factored form. I want you to put it in your calculator, see what that volume function looks like as a graph. You understand? Two things. Multiply this out. So we have a quadratic function that's all x squared and x and a constant, and then put it in your calculator as well. Okay, so we did it about 4x cubed minus 39x squared plus 93.5x.
Yes.
Yes, agree? Okay. That'll come in handy in a minute. And that looks like well, that's about what we thought, right? Something graph should look something like that. What do you think this value is right here?
4.25.
And this one?
5.5.
Here, let's test it out. Here's the trace, and I'll hit 4.25. Zero, 5.5. Zero. Naturally. Mimics the real world issue we're talking about. So what we want to find is this guy right here. Any ideas how we can find this x value right here, right below the maximum value?
Trace.
We gotta use trace. I mean. Is it the best, most accurate?
No.
How can we do it? Using calculus, of course.
What are you asking?
I'm asking, how do we find, well, this is where the volume maxes out, right? It's getting bigger, it's getting bigger, it's getting its biggest, and then coming back down. Right? So how do we find that x value right there, right below the maximum value? What's true about the derivative up here at the maximum?
Zero.
Equals
zero.
Zero. The slope is zero, yes. So, if this is our function, take the derivative, we got v prime. What does v prime tell us about v of x? slope, which is also what?
Tangent line.
Oh, yeah. The slope of the tangent line.
And change of volume.
The change in volume, the rate of the change, the instantaneous rate of change of volume, given a certain side length. Now, it's not time, right? It's not like it's changing with time. We're just changing the x. So if I change the x, if I'm at this x, for that given value of x, how fast is the volume change? So you take the derivative, we do take the derivative. 12x squared minus 78x plus 93.5. What do we say is true about the derivative at that point, at that maximum point?
It's zero.
It's zero. So how do we use the derivative to figure that out? Set it equal to zero, because we don't know what x is, but we do know whatever x we plug in, we will get zero. Get 12x squared minus 8x, 93.5. Then you factor this quadratic. Now that's silly. How are we gonna find the solution to this equation? Negative b square root square minus 4 a c. Over 2. I think we're going to use the plus or the minus, do you think?
Plus.
The plus. You got a positive 78. You're going to add something on. Probably could be subtracted. Maybe we should go. Let's look back at our guesses. 2.125? 2? Actually, it turned out to be a little bit less than that. So, no, I went ahead and looked back again. 1.59. What about this 4.9146?
That's the biggest volume.
The biggest negative volume. I don't even know if you call that a volume. That's a weird thing. Right, that 4. Whatever we just said, that's this guy right here. And this mystery value actually turns out to be a bit less than we thought. Even to the left. Right. So, now this is a problem we might encounter in we're in chapter 3 now, but in 3, I think, all the way. Optimization problem. What's the best value of x to get the best volume? We're going to start, though, to show you why we're doing what we're doing. In 3.1, we're finding extrema on an interval. Okay, so chapter 3 is going to be about this. It's about that. Graphing by hand. Okay, pretty much. We can gather so much information about a function and its graph that we almost don't need a calculator. And also optimization. What is optimization? It is an example of optimization, what we just did. What is optimal? What's the optimal value of x or whatever? What's the optimal time? What's the optimal length? So, we'll start off with the basics. If I want to, for a given function,
let's use the book for a sample problem because they make sure that they
work out pretty nicely most of the time. So this is 3.1 right now. We are going to have a chapter 2 test, but I'm going to make it wait until the next quarter. Okay? That's why you see we not be doing it. We got to do it. We're going to have one just later. assumption. Let's find all the extreme values of that. So we take the derivative, we use the product rule. We go to the chain rule. Right? So the first function's derivative is negative 3, and the second function. Take the first function and the derivative of the second, right? So 1 half power, you get 1 half times the function. So the negative 1 half times the derivative of the inside function, but that's just 1. So how did I get from here to here? Multiply the square root and 2, right? By 2 root x plus 1. Here it canceled out the denominator. Here I got a 2 times negative 3 is negative 6, and the square roots multiply together, and we get x plus 1. We get the minus 3x. Distribute the negative 6, we get negative 6x minus 3x. 9x, negative 6 times 1, negative 6, solve, we get negative 2 times. So that's, what's the significance of this number?
That's one of the maximum, the maximum of the original function.
Okay, is it definitely a maximum?
No, it's not.
Could be a minimum. Could be a maximum or a minimum.
Yeah. How do you know the difference?
How do you know the difference is a good question. Well, can we use the original function to figure out?
Yeah.
How so? I want to know, well, first, what's the y value at negative 2/3?
0.
That's what the derivatives were. The y value is decided by the original function, right? So if I get your 2/3 in there, and see what kind of y value you get. Put 20 down in there, and f of negative 2/3 is 3 times negative 2/3 times negative 2/3 plus 1, and negative 2 times negative 2/3 plus 1, that's 3/3, 2/3, 3/3, 1/3. Square root 1 over the square root of 3. Square root 1 is 1. Yeah, 1 over the square root of 3. Rationalize the denominator, we get 2 root 3 over 3. So this is the y value at negative 2/3. The y value at negative 2/3. So what we're asking is that the biggest value? Is it maxing out? Or is that the smallest value? Is it minimizing out?
Maximum.
What do you think max?
Positive? Oh, wait, no, that's not true.
Not necessarily true.
No.
Because it could be still, it could be positive, but it could be something like this.
Yeah.
So the smallest value. Ideas? How can we figure out which is it lower than all of the y values around it, or is it higher than all the y values around it? Looking to the left and the right, we should probably find some y values around this y value and see what we get. Okay? So, thinking negative 2/3 is like right there, and we get a y value of 2 root 3 over 3.
So we try like negative 2 and 1.
Negative 2 down here?
Yeah.
Okay, let's try negative 2. Put negative 2 in there. What do you get?
6. 1 root negative 1.
So 6i? That's imaginary, right? So what happened?
The graph doesn't go that far.
The graph doesn't exist there. It's not within the domain of the function. All right. Can we go to negative 1?
Yes.
We can't, because negative 1 just gives us a 0 in the square root. That's okay. squared is 0 to 0.
Yes.
So what do we get?
3.
We get
0.
0, right? 3 times 0.
Right.
0. Okay? And?
Try 1. Yeah.
Just 0.
Try 1?
Yes.
Zero.
0. When you put in 1, you get 0 again?
No.
You put
now
you're
getting
0.
Oh, you put in 0.
Oh, from
0. Oh, that's a nice pick. So is it a maximum or a minimum?
Maximum.
It's a maximum. All the values between these two, they go up, they pop off, they max out, and our graph must look something like this. We already have an okay graph of this function. We know it doesn't exist past negative 1 because that's where the square root is undefined. We know it comes up to a maximum of 2 root 3 over 3. Comes back down to 0. Oh wait, I forgot, maybe it comes back up like this. Does it do that?
No.
Why not? How do you know?
If we have another 0.
When we solved, yeah, when we set the derivative equal to 0 and solved, we would have found another solution. So it must be that it just keeps going down. It's never going to come back up. It might look a little bumpier than that. It might not be a nice smooth curve, but still, it's never going to have a derivative of 0 anymore, slope of 0. Now I want you to find the most maximum, the absolute maximum, the absolute minimum on this interval. So when I write these brackets, I mean these are the x values from negative 1, from x is negative 1 to x is 2. What does the square bracket mean?
No,
the opposite. It's including. And so the square bracket means including 2 as well, so including negative 1 and including 2. Okay? Which means if you plug a negative 1 into the function, you get an output. If we had a round parentheses, it would not include negative 1. So we could figure out what the function was getting close to it to actually get output. Okay? Because it would not include negative 1. But it includes negative 1 and includes 2, so I want you to find the all the maximum and minimum values. Most maximum and the most minimum value on that interval. Right, so we take the derivative. 2. Set it equal to 0. Solve it, x equals 1. So you think that's what? Where we find a what?
Minimum.
A minimum. Is it in this interval?
Yes. It's
kind of, so it is. Why do you think it's a minimum?
Because I put the same on both sides.
Okay, so you look on the left and the right. Also, what kind of a shape is this? Does it open down or up? So it must, you know, it looks like this. If we found that zero slope, we can feel pretty good that it's a minimum, right? So we found a minimum at, yes?
So that bracket, that means that your x value has to be in between those two?
Right. Like if I try to plug in an x value in this function
and you got like
to the left or the right of the left or the right of the interval, then it wouldn't be valid.
Okay.
So this guy, where is at, like this point, this minimum is at 1, comma what?
0.
1, 0?
Negative.
1, negative 1. We put it back in here, remember. That's getting the y value of the point on the graph, okay? What about the maximum value? Finding the maximum?
No. It goes off.
Does it?
What's
that?
I just hand graphed it. Well, no, it's not. Okay, negative 1. I think it's 3.
Negative 1, 3?
No, like, I think I have x. It is negative 1, 9. Maximum is 3.
X is negative 1, the y is 3, and that's the maximum.
Yeah.
I think you're right. The point is, it's on a closed interval,
right?
Meaning that actually the graph doesn't go off forever because we've cut it off. We put it inside an interval, and so we have to also look at the left and the right sides to see, does that give us a maximum or a minimum value? Well, if I look at the left and the right side, am I going to get a value that's more minimum than the minimum I found? No, that's the absolute minimum of the function no matter what. On this interval, though, maybe the left side is a little bit higher, or the right side, either the left or the right side may be higher than the other. So we plug in negative 1. We got 1, negative 1, and we got 3. So we get a point at, let's see, this is 1, this is 0, it's negative 1, so I guess we should put a little y, or x-axis here. And so negative 1, 3, and if we go over 2, plug in 2, 4, 0. So our absolute minimum is? Very good. Y equals negative 1. The minimum value is the y value. You give me the x value, you know where it is, but you don't know what the y value is. So the absolute minimum is negative 1. And is there an absolute maximum on this interval?
Yes.
And it is? It is the maximum value. I know this is a lot of, like, technicalities and vague functions and things like that, but sometimes when calculus is, you have these functions and you want to talk about them, which was the maximum value, was the minimum value, is there no maximum, is there no minimum?
So does that mean if it didn't have the ones in the bracket, that it would just be a maximum?
Yeah, there would be no max. There would be no maximum value because there's just no limit to it.
I mean, so if it's the round brackets, that means you can't plug in negative 1.
Right.
Or the numbers in the bracket.
Let's just copy this page real quick so we don't lose it all. And talk about that real quick. That is the next point. So you just said if we had the round brackets, if we changed it to have a round bracket, say just on the left side, it doesn't have to be both.
That's what that means.
So, negative 1 is not something we can plug in to the function. Not exactly.
It has to be greater than negative
1. Yeah, it's got to be to the right of negative. It could be negative 0.9999, whatever. But it can't be negative 1. So, we have the advantage of the experience of dealing with this function already. If there's going to be a maximum value, it's going to be at 3, and I'm going to get 3 when I plug in negative 1. But it's an open interval. I don't have negative 1 to plug in there. So now it's an open interval. Now what's the maximum value? What is the absolutely maximum value?
Something a little bit smaller than 3.
Something a little bit smaller than 3. Maybe 2.9. Can I get 2.9? See, when I plug in negative 1, I can get 3. But I can't plug in negative 1 because I don't include negative 1 in the interval. So could I get 2.9 out of it?
Yes.
I could go slightly to the right of negative 1, I'd be at 2.9. Can I get 2.99 out of it?
Yes.
Can I get 2.99999 out of it?
Yes.
Can I keep going like this forever?
Yeah. Yes.
Is there a biggest number that I can get?
2.9.
2.9 infinity? No?
Can't reach
2.9 infinity is 3. You can't get to 3. Can I get as close as I want?
Yeah.
Is there a value so close to 3 that I can't get any closer to 3?
No.
Not mathematically. All right. So what's the maximum? Is the maximum maybe 0 over here on the other side? Like the y value I get here is 0? Is that it? That's 2, 0. The maximum value means the y value that is the biggest on the interval. Okay, is it 0? Because that's the, like, I can plug in 2 into the function, and you know that comes up to a hard stop at 0. guys know what you say?
Yeah.
Man, this for you.
I don't think so. It's still not as maximum as 2.9.
Exactly, right? It is, at least locally, right, in this little local area, what we call a local maximum. But absolute on the interval, no. It's not the maximum. So what is the maximum?
-2.9.
Not 2.99?
Infinity.
No,
that's negative. Like 2.9 repeating.
Negative? It's positive.
Positive.
Why not?
2.9 repeating.
2.9 repeating for infinity is 3.
So it's 3.
But we can't get 3 because I can't plug in negative 1.
You should just say it approaches.
It does approach it.
3.
Does it ever get there?
Yep.
Is 2.9 bigger than 0? It is. Is there a maximum value that we can get? Is more maximum than any other value on that interval?
Say that again. No.
Is there a biggest y value on this interval where we can't plug in negative 1?
No.
No. There is no absolute maximum on that interval. That's the point. Because even though it seems like there should be, because it's not going to go any bigger than 3, but there is no y value that's the biggest y value. It can keep getting as close as you want to 3 and never quite getting there. No matter how close you get to 3, right? No matter how close Josie gets to 3, I can get closer. And she can get closer. And it's like that game where you're trying to grab the top of the bat to see who goes first, and don't know if you'll ever win because you'll never get to the top of the bat, because you can just keep splitting that difference forever. So if your only hope for a maximum is on one end of the interval, but the interval doesn't include that value, if you don't have you either want maximum, minimum, about, let's just look at some pictures real quick. Okay, and I'm not putting arrows on this, so it does not keep going forever. Okay, and let me just, adjust it a little bit. Okay, so those are like hard ends to this function. Does this have an absolute maximum?
Yeah.
Yes.
Where is it?
Like 3.
So let's give it, let's call this A, and this is B. Actually, we'll go from A to B. So we'll call this B. We'll call this C, and we'll call this D. We'll call this all those values of interest we gave them. Is there an absolute maximum?
Yeah.
What is it?
B
is the maximum, right? E, the y value. B is the maximum. So absolute max y equals B. Is there an absolute minimum?
Yeah.
Where? At F, the absolute minimum. What's that mean? Oh, but it doesn't include like that side of the interval is a round parentheses. Now what do we say? Does it change anything we know about over here?
Yeah, there's no absolute max.
There is no absolute max. Because we can never get to E. We can get to, I don't know what number would be before E, but we can get as many 0.999s as we want, leading up to E, and never quite get there. But always getting closer. Always possible to find a number that's bigger than any one you choose. It's kind of a weird concept, because you would think that means it goes on for infinity, like it just keeps getting bigger. It doesn't, it just means it's getting closer to the value, infinitely close. What if we put that open guy right there? What does that change?
Nothing.
You agree? Are you sure it's nothing? Changes nothing?
We have one at this point.
Huh? void?
Yeah.
Well, that's like debatable.
Okay.
But sure. Let's say we have one. We took that point out. Let's say. And well, we have a absolute minimum here, absolute maximum here. What about this? Isn't this a maximum? We've kind of ignored it.
It's a local.
Local. Or relative. Yes. Slash. Relative. You guys are quiet. You're just so excited about your costumes.
What are you doing?
And your little orange pumpkins. You're gonna go knock on doors and get candy. Or?
Are you taking your kids trick or treating?
Of course.
I haven't dressed up since. What are you talking about?
Are you dressing up to be?
I guess so. I couldn't care less about
yours.
Could not care less. By the way, if I said I could care less, what would that mean?
You could care
less.
You care a little bit.
It's like there's no absolute minimum to that function. Am I caring?
That's so true.
I could care less. Could I care? Yes, I could care less. And then I could care less and less. What does that mean? It means I care some. I want to express that I don't care. I can't care any less. I am at the absolute minimum caring. That was improvised right there. That was amazing.
That was great. That was
good. And it's on tissue.
That's good.
Recorded forever. As long as YouTube is around. Or that external hard drive. Whichever and last. Okay.
Where's the microphone?
My guy writes it.
By the calendar?
Just
some vocab I want you to know. Critical number. Connor, what's a critical number?
Critical numbers? Number that's critical.
Oh my gosh, I totally remember this.
I know, but you don't.
No, you don't. You haven't said
where.
It's where the graph is not legal, basically. Undefined?
That prime equals zero.
It's like
or,
the.
Oh, where it's the slope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where is
it's the cusp.
Oh, man,
where is the slope? Where is the slope? Critical number is an x value where f prime of x is zero or f prime of x is undefined.
It's this.
When could f prime be undefined?
Asymptotes?
Yeah.
Like an open.
Like a whore?
Or all that.
Sure? Okay.
One of those.
One of those what?
This!
What is that?
It's a cusp!
A cusp. Right? Pointy things do not lend well to finding derivatives. There's no tangent to that curve because it's not a curve, it's a point. Right? What's the tangent? Well, think about the tangent line as the line that goes through it only once. Well, there. Is a quote tangent lines, that's tangent two, that one's tangent. See how there's no curve to kind of rest on and be tangent to. It's like a teeter. So yeah, it's a teeter shot. So absolute versus local slash relative max. What's the difference?
Absolute is on like the entire graph.
Yeah.
Local slash relative is just like a certain area.
Just right in here. Not absolutely maximum, but right in this area. An absolute maximum would be like this guy. Is it? Oh, did I say absolute? I meant relative.
That's local.
That's local. That's relative. If the graph stops here, that's absolute. Or if it kind of went up and came back down, then we know it goes down forever. This guy would be absolute. This would be local. Local to just to the right and just to the left.
Are there limit derivatives?
Limit derivatives.
Yeah, like you have a limit x
derivative.
I don't know what you
mean, Jose. Limit derivatives.
Derivatives
of limits?
Limit
of a derivative? Not right now. And then same for the minimum, right? It's the absolute and there's the local slash relative.